What gave the United Kingdom, Britain, England, what gave the United Kingdom the right to promise Palestine to a group of Europeans involved in the Zionist movement at the beginning of this century? That's your first question. What right did England have? What right did the United Kingdom have to promise this piece of land to fellow Europeans? Neither did England own this land, nor did the Europeans they promised it to have anything to do with it in recent history. This is your first question, because this is where the history of the illegitimate state of Israel begins. Before this point in time, there is no actual history. And the biggest culprit to set everything in motion is the United Kingdom. The United Kingdom, England, Britain, is of course the last of the colonizing forces. Our own country of America broke away from England 280 years ago because of the tyranny, because of how they felt about people of their own ethnicity, people of their own language. So England has a history of colonization and a history of trying to be an imperialist power. Palestine is the last project of colonialism. Palestine is the last settler colonization of pre-modernity, and we are still suffering from the consequences. We are all aware Palestine had been ruled by the Muslims since the time of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, uninterrupted except for a brief interlude under the Crusaders for around 90 years. And during that point in time, it was open for anybody to come, to live, to worship, to pray. There has not been a single case of civil war, of religious strife in the time of the Muslims. Muslims lived with Christians, with Jews, together until the Crusaders came and shed blood for the first time. And then the Zionist enterprise was founded in the 1940s. So here's the first question. What gives Britain the right to promise Palestine to a group of Europeans in the Zionist movement in the turn of the century? Because we're all aware that England made three contradictory and mutually exclusive promises. They blatantly lied to three separate entities about Palestine. Publicly, they promised the Arabs independence from the Ottomans if they rebelled against the Ottoman Caliphate. And they said to the Sharif of Mecca, the great-great-great-grandfather of the current King of Jordan, they said to the Sharif of Mecca, they said to him, if you fight against your fellow Muslims and you fight against the Ottomans, we will make you the Khalifa and we will give you an Arab land from Iraq all the way to Tunisia. It will be yours. So they promised the Sharif of Mecca power. And they said, all we want you to do is fight against your fellow Muslims, the Ottoman Empire. Rebel against them and we'll make you the Khalifa. And of course, he didn't learn from previous mistakes, and current rulers don't learn from past mistakes. The promises of these superpowers are not even worth the air that they're spoken with, much less the paper they are written on. And so, completely coincidentally, on the 5th of June, today is what day, guys? Today is what day? The 5th of June. We didn't plan this way. On the 5th of June in 1916, that is 105 years ago. Today is the anniversary. Today, 105 years ago, the Sharif of Mecca attacked the Ottoman Empire. And do you know where he began the attack? Do you know which city he chose to begin the attack? Can anybody guess? Who knows? Close. Medina. Can you see the mentality? And I have to say this, even though this isn't the talk here. Yes, the ultimate blame lies on the outsider. The ultimate blame is on the superpowers and the imperialist forces. But the brutal fact of the matter is that those outside forces could not do what they did without internal traitors. And that is the ultimate reality. They could not do what they did if they didn't have people from within our own ranks pretending to be a part of us who cooperated with them against the interests of the Ummah. And so this individual waged war against the Ottomans. He attacked Medina on the 5th of June 1916, thus breaking away from the Ottoman Empire, hoping hoping that he would be the next Khalifa, because the promise was, if you break away, O Sharif of Mecca, you will be the next Khalifa, and you will have Palestine, you will have Iraq, you will have Syria, you will have Egypt, all of it will be yours. And of course, this miskeen, this fool, did not know that behind his back, even as the British are promising him he will become the Khalifa, they already have a secret agreement with the French, with the Russian superpowers, and this is known as the Sykes-Picot Agreement. The Sykes-Picot Agreement was a hidden agreement. It was a secret agreement. Already decided that after World War I, just like the Muslim Ummah is a beautiful apple pie, each one is gonna get a piece of the pie. And they already had a map. You can Google it. It's on Wikipedia, the actual map that Sykes and Picot, a Frenchman and a Britishman, argued over. And they drew these imaginary boundaries. Those imaginary boundaries are still in effect to this day. So as the British are telling the Arabs, rebel and you will be the Khalifa, they already have a secret agreement, the Sykes-Picot Agreement, and they've divided the Muslim lands amongst the superpowers, and technically, according to the Sykes-Picot Agreement, Palestine would be independent mandate. Nobody would have control over it. That was the secret agreement. Then they had an even more secret agreement, three agreements simultaneously. And that secret agreement was even more secret than the Sykes-Picot. At least the Sykes-Picot was known to the three superpowers, their embassies, their presidents, their czars. They knew the Sykes-Picot agreement. As for the third promise and the third agreement, this was even more hidden, and it only came to light many years later. And we have the original. These are no conspiracy theories. And this is, of course, the infamous Balfour Declaration. The infamous Balfour Declaration of 1917, in which the Foreign Minister of England promised Lord Balfour, who was the representative of the World Zionist Federation, that if they helped them in World War I, that England would then hand Palestine over to the European Zionists, right? So this is something that was a secret promise, that if you help us, we're gonna give you Palestine. And who are the Zionists? Long story here, but very briefly, Zionism is a European project began by secular Jewish people, not religious Jews. In 1897, Theodor Herzl and others, they were the first to begin speaking of a modern state in what is now Palestine. And when they began this project, religious Jews across the world rejected Zionism. This is well known. American Jews in particular had nothing to do with Zionism. They were not supportive of it at all. The Orthodox rabbis scoffed at Zionism. They thought it to be a type of heresy. They said, God will give us the kingdom when we're worthy of it. You cannot politically get the kingdom by killing and by causing massacres. This is what the Orthodox rabbis said. And there is still a small group of them, the Natura Cartae, that is still around to this day, that have those original beliefs of those rabbis. Nonetheless, the project begun. And slowly but surely, because of the rising anti-Semitism, because of the rise of the Nazi party, because of a number of events, including the Dreyfus Affair, you can Google this, Zionism gained traction amongst secular-minded and then slowly even religious-minded Jewish people. And so when World War I broke out, England felt it to be advantageous if they promised Palestine to the Zionist Federation. Now, what gives England the right to promise a land that is not theirs to a people that have nothing to do with it? This is the first question, and this is where it all begins. Remember, dear Muslims, remember this simple statistic. At the turn of the century, around 1900, there were barely 3% Jewish people in Palestine. This was the normal, this was the standard percentage for many millennia, 3%. And these are Jewish Arabs. They speak Arabic. They're living amongst the Muslims. There has never been a single case of war, of civil war, of massacre, of murder, nothing. Jewish Arabs and Muslims and Christians are living side by side until the Zionist project begins. So in 1917, England promises Palestine to this Zionist entity. And of course, this promise is based on, frankly, a very racist, superiorist, nationalistic mindset. The fact of the matter is that there must be an outright racism involved. Europeans, still to this day, but especially back then, did not view Arabs and Muslims as being equally human. Those brown and colored folks, they're not the same as us. And deep down inside, they had remnants of their Christianity, even though they claimed to be secular. And they had a dismissive attitude towards Islam. Not that they loved people of a Jewish background, but they hated Muslims more than they hated the Jews. That's really what it is. They hated Muslims, and they dismissed Muslims more than they dismissed people of a Jewish background. Deep down inside, they saw Jewish people as still being an extension of their own, even if they didn't like them as fully equals, but at least the Judeo-Christian culture is a whole and the Islamic culture is outside. So they felt that by promising Israel, by promising Palestine to Zionists, they are fulfilling a Christian, a messianic promise that Jesus will only return when the Jews have gathered in the Holy Land. This is their belief. It is the belief of Baptists to this day. And deep down inside, there is an element of associating modern Judaism with the ancient children of Israel and modern Palestine with the ancient kingdom of David. This is really what it is. There is no actual secularism. Their deep-seated religious convictions are coming to light with these types of promises.